All righty. Well, welcome to the final week of It Is Complicated. And if you've ever been in a relationship, you know that it's complicated. I mean, everything about it is complicated, from the closet to the checking account to the where you go to church to how you raise your kids to how to discipline your kids, how many kids you're going to have. I mean, the whole thing is complicated. And before I get into this final message, one, I want to remind you about what you just heard about, and that's the Dream Team Party. Come on, I'm excited about that. That's going to be exciting. Are you anybody? Is anybody? Yeah, come on. It's pretty exciting. If you ain't clapping, you either ain't on a team or you haven't been to a Dream Team Party. They are a blast. And this year's going to be a little bit different. It's going to be a fine dining experience. So we want you to come dressed up, as dressy as you want to be, as glittered up as you want to get. And that's going to be on March the 28th, starting at 5 p.m. And so you've got an invitation. We'll give you more information. But if you're on a Dream Team, we have some people in Growth Track right now that are going to graduate just in time to make the Dream Team Party. 17 people went through Growth Track last week. Come on, that's exciting. Pretty exciting. Some of those are going to end up on some teams that you're on, and so we're so pumped about that. We're excited about what God is doing here at WRC and continues to do. We got a bright future. We have some land about 1 mile north of here. I think we might be on our final version of the drawing, possibly. It's only drawing number 9, so we're getting there. We're going to show you those drawings as soon as we finish those up. We're excited about that. And so guys, there's some awesome stuff. Going to put almost $20,000 from last month into the building fund this month. Come on, that's exciting. That's going to put us right almost at $300,000. So we're excited about what God's doing here at WRC, and we're glad you're here to do it with us. And so we're excited about that. I'm excited about this series. This series has been a fun one to do. Before I get too deep into it, let me tell you about something that's coming up. We normally do 21 days of prayer early in the year. This year, we've moved it to this time, and here's why. Because the next 3 weeks, we're going to be teaching you how to pray more effectively. And they're going to be powerful. And if you have a lost loved one, or you have somebody you want to get prayed for, this is a great time to do this. We're going to spend 21 days praying together. And here's what it's going to look like. We're going to start that next week for the next 3 weeks. We're going to do that. We're going to start next Monday morning, not tomorrow, but next Monday, right here, 6 a.m. We're going to have some cards that you can fill out to put prayer requests on, and we're going to take time to pray over each one of those. So come. It's about 45 minutes. We'll get you out of here by 7 a.m. The other times of the week, we're going to just be posting videos on social media, so you can spend some time, get up early with us, pray together. If you want to do that, like do it from your work, do it in your car, do it at your house, however you want to do that. So that's what it's going to look like. On the Mondays for the next 3 Mondays, not tomorrow, but starting next week, we're going to meet up here at 6 a.m. from the Mondays, and every other day we're just going to be posting online videos, and then on Sundays at 8:30 in the hub like we normally do. So don't miss that. That's going to be an awesome time together. We're going to be teaching on that for the next 3 weeks. You don't want to miss it. It's so powerful, such good stuff. And so you know, we have a book called Praying Effectively for the Lost, and if you don't have one, we have them at Next Steps in the Breezeway. Grab you one. They're free. We give those away. So I want to tell you all about that before we jump in this morning. Today I want to share a message that we don't talk about a lot here at WRC, we should talk about it more because it's the thing that Jesus talked about the most. This is the subject that Jesus talked about the most, and that is money. Yeah. So I waited until the Sunday where you came in groggy from losing an hour of sleep, and I said, you know, that's the Sunday we're going to talk about money. So today, because it's important, man, money, and it's complicated. In our relationships, money is a big deal. In fact, it's one of the biggest reasons why people get divorces. It's the biggest reasons our relationships don't work out because of money. So today, I want to give you the 4 money languages, but before I do that, I want to give you a few scriptures about what the Bible says about money. Now, if you've, like me, you've had some money fights in your relationship. How do you spend it? How much do we save? Do we have fun, or do we go on vacation, or do we put the kids through college? Like, how do we do that? Right now, we're having wedding money conversations. You know, like, we can either go buy those flowers, or we can make them. Let's make the flowers. That's what we're going to do. We've been at Mimi's house making flowers. That's what we've been doing. So, but you have to do some things. I'm going to give you some 4 practical steps at the end. I'm going to give you 4 practical ways to make money less complicated in your life. But here's what the Bible says about money in Matthew chapter 6, verse 21. It says, wherever your treasure is, there your desires of your heart will be also. Now, I want to talk about treasure, because the word treasure does mean treasure, and it does mean valuables, but more than that, it has a different connotation. It has a different meaning. In fact, the primary meaning of the word treasure is really a location. It's where you store the thing that's valuable. So I want you to get this. So where you store, because here's what you would say, wherever my treasure, I don't have a treasure. I got $18 in my banking account. I don't have no treasure. But what that really is saying is, if you had a treasure, where would you put it? That's what it's really saying. If you had something valuable, if your checking account had $20,000 in, what would you spend it on? Where would you put that treasure? That's really what it's saying, is what is the location? It's not saying that if you have valuables. It's saying if you had the valuables, where would you put them? Let me say it like this. Your treasure is not the purchase you place. It's the place of the purchase. Huh. That's a good word right there. I'm going to read that one more time. Your treasure is not the purchase you place. It's where you place the purchase. See, it ain't about having stuff. It ain't about collecting things and having a nice house and having nice cars and having nice stuff. It ain't about that. It's where that is placed in your life. That's really what he's saying. Where the placement of your treasure is where your heart will be also. It's not the purchase you place. It's where you place the purchase. Are y'all getting that? That's a good word right there. Yeah, see, yeah, that 1 hour got y'all, because that's a good word. I mean, that's... Thank you, Ms. May. See, it ain't about having stuff. And the Bible doesn't say money is really all. It's the love of money. In other words, it's where you place your money. Are you willing to help people with it? Or are you going to hoard it for yourself? Is it all about you, or is it about other people? It's where your treasure is. There will your heart. There will your desires be also. It's the place that you put it. In fact, it's funny because one of the definitions for that word treasure we looked at is casket. Like, where is your life? That's what he's really saying. Where like, what's your dash look like? And by the way, when I say dash, I mean... When your headstone reads, mine would say 1977 to 2077. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to be 100 when I die, at least. Corona ain't getting me. You know what I'm saying? I'm doing the Corona kick. I learned that from Steve this morning. Do the Corona kick. Don't even high-fiving, but you do the Corona kick. It ain't getting me. So let's just say I live 100 to be 100. What did my dash represent? That's really what it's saying. What treasure? What did you come up? What did you do? And here's a question I want to give you, and we're going to ask this a couple times, and really it's one that you have to answer, and you and your family have to answer, and you and your spouse have to answer. Here's the question: who is the Lord of your money? Who is the Lord of your money? Because here's the reason why people get angry when we talk about money in the church. It's because the Lord ain't the Lord of their money. Getting real in here real fast. I told you. If I'd have warned you we were talking about this, you wouldn't have came back. Oh, I overslept. It was weird waking up in the dark. You know what I'm saying? I was like, it's 2 a.m. What am I doing up? But listen, this is a big question. Who is the Lord of your money? Here's how you know. Look at your checking account and see where you spend your money. That's who's the Lord of your money. All right, we're going to move on. All right, y'all ain't too happy, but we'll keep going. Here's what the Bible says about money. No one can serve two masters. Either he will love the one and hate the other, or hate the one and love the other, or else he will be loyal to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. And the word for mammon is a demonic spirit. You cannot serve God and money and mammon. You can't do it. It's impossible. You can't serve two masters. You have one or the other. You can serve one of them. And what we do is we try to go back and forth, right? We serve God on Sunday mornings, but then Monday rolls around, we're back to mammon. This is important. We got to get this. You cannot serve the two masters. And people do it all the time. There's a story in the New Testament I want to read to you. It's exciting. It's about people who did the wrong thing and died for it. So this is going to be great. Y'all ready for this? This is an example of trying to serve God and money right here. I'm about to show you what it looks like, and the ending isn't great. Here's how the story goes. At the end of Acts chapter 4, the Bible, if you read Acts 1 through 4 up to this point, man, people are loving each other. Man, they're selling their stuff. They're giving their stuff away. The Bible says all the believers were united in heart and mind. And they felt that they felt that what they owned was not even their own. In other words, their treasure didn't trump Jesus, is what I'm saying. It was about the other people. It was Bernie Sanders could have wrote this. I'm just saying. All right. sorry. That I should have went there. Just popped in my head. They felt not with their own, but listen, they were about sharing everything they had. About sharing everything they had. And then here's the verse. Here's the first verse of the next. The very next verse is chapter 5, which the Bible wasn't written in chapters and verses. So this is the next verse. But you don't want to be this but right here. I'm telling you right now. You do not want to be this but. But there was a certain man named Ananias who, with his wife Sapphira, sold some property. No big deal, right? They had some stuff. They sold it. Not a big deal. He brought part of the money to the apostles, claiming it was the full amount. With his wife's consent. So he kept the rest. He wanted to get a bass boat, and he said, look, you know what? We'll sell the money. They were fishermen, right? I mean, who wanted to get him a nice, a Ranger, I don't know, really nice bass boat with a 200 on the back of it so he could beat everybody else to the good fishing spots. So they sold the money. He kept half. He kept the rest. Then Peter said, Ananias, why have you let Satan fill your heart? You lied, not to us. You lied to the Holy Spirit. And you kept some of the money for yourself. The property was yours to sell or not to sell. In other words, you didn't even have to sell it. What he was saying is you didn't have to sell that. You could have kept it. You could have put your future generations on it. You could have built a nice house on it. You didn't have to sell that stuff. You could have done as you wished. After selling it, the money was also yours to give away. In other words, okay, it was yours. You decided to sell it, and you could have just kept it. You could have got a bass boat and a truck to pull it. You know what I'm saying? Like an F-250. You could have really got something nice if you're a Ford guy. If you're not, it's no big deal. You could have got a Toyota. Everybody's a Toyota guy, right? You could have got you a Tundra with a Ranger with matching colors. That's what Peter was saying. Peter was saying, you could have did what you wanted. It was your land. You could have did whatever you wanted. It was yours to give away. How could you do a thing like this? You weren't lying to us, but to God. And here's what I want you to see this morning. Here's the next verse. This is where it gets good. You ready for this? And as soon as he heard these words, he fell on the floor and died. So we're going to pass the offering plates this morning. No, really. No, we're not. Who heard about it was terrified. He didn't die because he didn't give all of his money. He didn't die because he only gave half. He died because he said he was doing something he wasn't doing. That was the problem. He placed his treasure above Jesus is really what he did. And he said he was doing it and he really wasn't. Here's verse 6. And some of the young men got up, wrapped him up in a sheet, and took him out and buried him. Like, no big deal. All right, there was another one went down. And if you keep reading, we don't have time to keep reading, but if you keep reading, you'll see his wife came in. She lied, too. She fell dead, and they buried her next to him. That's good. I guess they saved some money on getting two for one with the gravesite. I don't know. They had to use some of that money for that. But listen, it was about the mindset. Here's what I want you to say. It's not the purchase you place. It's where you place the purchase. Well, let me say it a different way. God is more concerned about your motive than he is your money. He's more concerned about your motive than he is your money. So we got to understand money. We got to wrap our mind around this idea about money. And listen, it's something that I don't think the church, I think some churches, we probably talk about it too much, and some we don't talk about it enough. We're probably more in this ditch over here. But I want you to know that it's a big part. And in your relationships, it's huge. Because most of our fights were about money. And when we first got married, and even today, we don't really fight about it. Now we're just like, well, we don't have money. We have two weddings. That's what we have now. I'm picking. It really hasn't been that bad. Our girls are very frugal, and it's been going well. And so God's been blessed. But here's the deal. It's a big thing because we all see money differently. So today I want to give you the four love languages, or not love languages. We gave you that last week. The four money languages. And then at the end, I'm going to give you four practical ways to make your relationship a little bit better with your money. Here's the four money languages. I want you to see these this morning because every one of you fall in one of these categories. And let me just say this. There's not a right one and there's not a wrong one. All right. So when you see this, you're like, oh, that's me. It's not a bad thing. It's just the way you see money. It's the way God created you. It's like your love language is not better than the other ones. It's just the way you were created. So you just have to understand that. And when you see these, you're going to be like, oh, yeah, that's me. And when I saw this, y'all, it opened my eyes because Amy and I have two different money languages, completely different. And so I see it one way. She sees it another. But if we understand that, we're going to probably fight a little bit less about it and get up more on the same page. Here's number one is what they call the driver. So if driver is your money language, that means money means success. In fact, money is what drives you. It's what pushes you. It's what makes you click. You really see money as the more money you have, the more successful you are. Now, you would think everybody thinks that way, but not everybody does. That's not how everybody sees it. Here's number two, and that is amiable. Amiable money means love. This is me right here. That's why I like to, you know, I buy the kids stuff. I do. Whether it's a drink from the Circle R, Yeah, but what's the other name? There you go. Moss Love Buggies. Because, hey, look, they 79 cents and they're that big, all right? You got to get a PVC pipe to get it all out of there. By the way, we're probably going to give some discount cards when we build over there, and you just walk over there and get you one for 50 cents. But listen, I love, you know, if I'm at the store, Amy, this is why Amy don't send me to the grocery store right here. Because I love food. And my girls were specific. Hey, look, we're getting ready for this wedding. Don't bring cookies home. I brought two packs of cookies home. I got Chips Ahoy. I'm like, you know what? I really like double stuffed Oreos. Anybody? Here's how you, if you want to know how you eat those really, real quick, you get you a little cup of milk. If you don't want to get your fingers dirty and you like dipping them in milk, you take a fork and you put it between, and then you dip it down in there, and you count to about 8.5 seconds. Depends on how soggy you want it, you put on it. It's how you do it's how we do things at our house. But they don't send me, my wife, she's on a diet during Easter. I can't bring home, I want to bring home chocolate bunnies. She loves chocolate bunnies. I try not to. The other day I picked one up. I'm like, nope, I ain't getting it. I ain't going to this time. Money means love to me. Here's number three, and this might be you right here. Money means security. And this is Amy's love language. Money is security. So the more money we have, the more secure we are. Now, she's not a hoarder. She's a giver. I don't want you to think that one of these is wrong. There's nothing wrong with any one of them. It's just the way we see money. Mine is love, hers is security. So when I want to give the money away and love on whoever, and it could be a close family member, you know, she might say, you know what, we got some planning to do. Like, we have some stuff to pay for. We gotta take care of ourselves first. And so if there's nothing wrong, I'm gonna give you some downfalls from every one of these as well. I'm gonna give you some weaknesses, because all the weaknesses are important too. So the weakness of the if you're amiable, listen, people love to be around you. Right? Because you're buying on stuff. But your future might not look too bright because you ain't been saving nothing. You've been spending on everybody else. That's a problem. Like, you have to take care of your family. That's a problem. So I'm amiable. My money is love. That means, and then money can buy food. Therefore, food means love. Analytical means that money is security. Let me just tell you a quick story. Our first big fight that we had, we went to a restaurant and we was po. Y'all. I mean, we didn't have any money. Somebody invited us, and I'm like, yeah, we can come. Yeah, everybody else is going. We're going. I don't know. I mean, we got the money in the bank, but we also have a bill coming out in 2 days, and it ain't adding up is what I'm saying. We go out to eat. I had some cash, and I gave the cash to the guy, and it was like, I think it was like $28 or $25 or something, and I gave him two 20s. And he came back, and he was like, hey, man, he said, you need some change? I was like, no, man, keep it. Dude, that's the first time I remember getting the look. Just like, keep it. That's a $15 tip on a $25 ticket. But I love the dude, you know what I'm saying? That's a great example of the two. She sees security and I see, and they both can be dangerous. And I'm going to tell you how here in just a second. Here's number four, expressive. Money means respect. It means acceptance. It means that you've been accepted into a group. If you have certain things, you can be with a certain group. And so money means it means acceptance. And so I want you to get that. Those four. Let me give you the weaknesses real quick. These two I know about because they're in my life right now, but these two not so much. But you probably know some people, or you're one of these other ones. That's okay. There's nothing wrong with it. If money means success, you just have to be careful for some of these weaknesses. Here's a couple of them real quick. Let me give you the driver weakness is dependence for self-esteem. If money means success, that means when you don't have any, you don't feel good about yourself. That's a very dangerous pitfall right there. Here's the second one. Amiable means you're unprepared. It could mean that you're unprepared for the long run. In other words, if you love everybody else and you spend all your money helping them or getting them whatever it is that you think that they need, you're not ready for the long run. See, you want to be around somebody like this, but not if you live with them, because you might not have a future because you hadn't really been planning for it. Here's number three real quick. Analytical. Money can become a god. It can become your god. When it's all about security, all of a sudden your faith is in your money and not the Father. That's a real danger right there. I want you to get that. Don't miss it. Again, there's nothing wrong with any of these, but they all have their own weaknesses. So if this is analytical, is you, if you're analytic, then money can become your God. In other words, the more money you have, the more secure you are. Therefore, you don't need anything outside of yourself. You've got everything under control. This is very dangerous. Here's number four, expressive. Money hides the insecurities. So if you have the money and you're accepted, then really, you know, beneath the surface on your own, you might be in trouble. And here's because you don't really feel good about yourself. But as long as you have that money, then all of a sudden you're accepted and you're really hiding. It's really a mask is what I want to say. But here's what I want to tell you. You want to be separate from your spouse, and here's why. Now, if you're not, it's okay. There's nothing you can do about it. But if you're separate, it's not a bad thing. It's a great thing. You know why? It means you have different weaknesses. It means you have different strengths. See, Amy and I are different, and so we need to. I need her in my life. I need her to go. You know what? We really need to build that savings account back up. And I'm like, oh yeah. But I was thinking about doing this, but you're probably right. We should do this, and maybe you know she's leaning on the side of savings. I'm like, we should really probably help this. And so there's nothing wrong with either one of them. I don't want to cast a dark shadow on any of it because it's all good. But listen, the Bible is very clear that we need to love other people, but we also got to take care of our family. So there's a balance. You really need that balance. It's very, 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 very important. So let me give you four things this morning I want to give you. If you want to make money less complicated in your life, I want to give you four things that you need to do with your spouse or with your family or with your parents if you're younger. Here's number one. You need to talk about money. You need to talk about it. You need to have a conversation about money. Man, growing up, we didn't have those conversations, and probably because we didn't have any money. Really, Mom, there wasn't nothing to talk about, was there? No reason to talk about it when you ain't got it. So we just didn't talk about it. And so it's something that we sit down with our kids. We go, hey, look, you need to think about this. You're about to get married. The girl's about to get married. Think about a budget. Here's about what life is going to cost. And I remember the first time we talked about the numbers, they were like, it costs how much? I'm like, yeah, life is expensive. Car insurance, phone insurance, health care, it gets expensive. And then FICA comes in and just eats your lunch. Well, y'all know what FICA is. You know what I'm talking about. FICA comes in and just got teeth all in your stuff, and like you go home with half of what you thought you was going to go home with. You got to talk about this stuff. Talk about it with your spouse. Talk about it with your kids. You got to talk about it. Here's a verse I want to give you this morning. The Bible tells us about if we don't agree, if we don't have the conversation and we don't agree and we don't take these steps together, it's going to be trouble. Here's what it says. He knew their thoughts. This is what Jesus is saying to a group of people. And he said to them, any kingdom divided by civil war is doomed. In other words, you're going this way and I'm going that. We ain't talking about it. Have the conversation. He says, any family that's divided by a civil war is doomed. A family splintered by feuding will fall apart. You got to talk about it. You got to get on the same page. Here's what Amos 3:3 says. Can two people walk together unless they without agreeing on the direction? If you're going to go in the same direction, you got to talk about where you're going. And if it's Waze, use the Waze app. But y'all both agree that Waze is right and you go that way. It's about you got to be on the same page. Sit down and talk about it. Write up a budget. Talk about it with your spouse. This is very, very important. Two people can't even walk together unless they agree on the direction that they're going. So you have got to be in agreement with each other about where you're going and where this thing is taking you, because money will be a big issue in your life if you don't talk about it. Talk about it. Talk about it. Talk about it. Talk about it with your kids. Talk about things with your kids. This is important. Here's number two. After you talk about it, here's number two. You got to start doing this, and that's start tithing. If you have not started tithing, start tithing. This is a very big deal. It's a commandment in the Old Testament. Jesus talks about it in the New Testament. This is very important. Tithing, the definition of tithing means 10%. It means 10%. That's the actual definition of it. The Bible tells us that a story of two guys, Cain and Abel. And if you know, Cain killed Abel. But if you don't know why, well, let me just show you why. It was because of an offering. It was because one brought an offering and it was accepted, and the other one didn't. I'm going to tell you why they were today. Maybe you've never understood that. I know for a while I didn't. I read the story, and I'm like, God accepted one offering but not the other, but why didn't he? And then I got revelation, and I saw it, and I want you to see it this morning. But here's what the Bible says about those two in Hebrews, and we're going to jump back to Genesis. It says it was by faith, that Abel brought a more acceptable offering to God than Cain did. Abel's offering gave evidence that he was a righteous man, and God showed his approval on his gifts. Now, he brought a more acceptable gift than his brother did. Now, why? It was by faith he did it. Listen, if you're going to start tithing, it's going to take faith. I'm telling you right now, it's going to take some faith. You're saying, I can't pay my bills now. How am I going to give God 10%? I can't explain it to you, but I'm here to tell you it works, it works, it works. When I was, when we were younger, Amy and I first got married, I'm telling you, we were broke. And God convicted me one day. We were already tithing, but he said, I want you to start tithing on your gross and not your net. And I was like, oh, that's tough. But I said, okay, God, we're going to do it. And can I just tell you, a mathematician could not figure out how we had money at the end of the month. Nothing changed. Our income didn't change. Because God blesses it. He says that he will. I'll show you that here in just a second. But I want you to see the gift that was given. Look at this. Back in Genesis chapter 4, this is one of the first stories of the kids that Adam and Eve had. This is what the Bible says. When it was time for harvest, Cain presented some of his crops as a gift to the Lord. I want you to see that. He gave him something. He gave him some. Let's see. I got a little pile of bananas over there. Here you go. Let me just take those. Take a few of these apples. I got a couple of got worms on us. All right, go ahead. God, take them. He gave him some of this stuff. He gave him some as an offering. Here's the difference. Abel also brought a gift. The best portions. Do you see the difference? One brought just some of what he could find, what was laying around, and the other one looked and found the best that he could find and gave it to Jesus, gave it to God as an offering. Back in Genesis, this is important. He gave the best portions of his firstborn lambs of his flock, and the Lord accepted Abel's gift, but he did not accept Cain and his gift, and this made Cain very angry, and he looked rejected. And if you keep reading the story, he actually went and killed his brother over this right here. The first murder happened over money. Money makes things complicated. But here's the reason God accepted one, not the other, because it was the best of what he had. One gave something, and the other one gave the best. I'm just telling you, it's very important. Tithing is a big deal. In fact, Jesus tells the Pharisees in the New Testament, he says, listen, you tithe your herb gardens. You're actually bringing mint and cumin, and you're bringing 10% of that, yet you've neglected grace and mercy and all these other things. He said, you should have done the former without neglecting the latter. In other words, it's important. This is a big deal. And can I just tell you that tithing is not a money problem, it's a heart problem. When you give to the Lord, it's not a heart problem, it is a money problem. I mean, it's not a money problem, it's a heart problem. Every time. It has nothing to do with money. It's all about the heart. Here's what shocked me. We talked about this in prayer time this morning. We trust Jesus. This is crazy. We trust Jesus with our eternal salvation, but not with our finances. We trust him with our future, but not with our finances. That's a problem. We trust him with our future, but we don't trust him with our finances. Scott Davis made this statement one day, and I've said it up here a couple times, and that is this. We love to give God credit, but we won't give him cash. That's gold right there. Gold, I tell you. That's good stuff. We like to give God credit, but we won't give him cash. You know why? Because he's not the Lord of your money. He's not the Lord of my money. When I don't give him to him, that means he ain't the Lord of it. This is important. I know it's getting thick in here, but that's all right, because this is the kind of sermon it is. We're going to be all right. If you got your steel toes, wear them next week. Here's what Malachi 3:10 says about tithing. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse so that there will be enough food in my temple. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies. So he gives some promises. So he says, bring all the tithes to the storehouse. Now let me just say this. We have some outreach events that we do here. We have legacy, right? So we have five lanes. One of those, the primary lane that we focus on is building fund. It's the thing that's most important to us right now. I mean, yes, we want to help people. We want to feed people. We want to minister to people. We want to do some homeless outreach. We love all that. But our primary focus right now as a church, as a whole, is building the building. Are we going to stop doing ministry? No. We're going to keep doing outreach. That's still part of our budget. It's still part of what we do. We have a big event coming up in about a month for ABC Pregnancy Center. It's incredible. We're actually going to go bless them with some gifts, and you're going to be a part of that. And we want to do that. We have a backpack giveaway every year. And last year, over 400 people came through these gates, and we were able to actually give away 400 backpacks last year. We're probably going to give more like 500 or 600 away this year. We're going to keep doing ministry. But here's my point. When we bring all the tithes into the storehouse, and if you go through Growth Route, you'll understand the structure of how we do money here at WRC. I don't pick my tithe. We have a team that does that. I mean, not my salary. I have a salary. I have an amount that we don't pay the bills and I take home whatever's left. That's not how we do things here. We have very strict policies the way we do those things. So here's the cool part. When you give into the general fund, whatever comes in over budget goes straight to the building fund. That's how we do it. So when you bring all the tithes to the storehouse, we go, you know what, as a team, hey, let's make sure this is taken care of. We got this outreach to take care of, and we do all those things. But listen, this is not legacy and outreach. We're talking about tithing to the church. This is first and foremost. This is so important. So if you do, I'm gonna give you some promises. If you bring all the tithes to the storehouse, here's some promises. And let me just tell you, I'm not saying this to beg you for money, because listen, God don't need your money. He wants your heart. He don't need your money. He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And by the way, he owns the hills too. The earth is his footstool. He don't need your money. He wants your heart. Just hear me that. Don't hear what I'm not saying this morning. I'm not begging you. We're not going to pass the offer plate and go, I saw your W-2. That is not 10%. We're going to start that next year. Okay. No. That's not the heart of this message. But what I'm about to show you is why this message exists and why you need to hear it and why I need to talk about it more. Here it is. Look at this. If you will tithe, here's what I'm going to do for you. This is God's promise to you. He says, I will open up the windows of heaven for you, and I will pour out blessings so great you won't have enough room to take it all in. And I love the last part of the verse. He says, I want you to try it. Put me to the test. As far as I know, this is the only passage in the entire Bible, all 66 books of the Bible, where God says, test me, try me. And you just heard a testimony. If you were here about 3 weeks ago, you heard George Book and Carly give their testimony. They started tithing. They were in a house they were trying to get out of. And like Charles, they wanted to be more this way. And so anyway, they started tithing even when they didn't feel like they could. They did it anyway. And just a few months later, they had a down payment on a house right here in Ragley. And listen, can I just tell you, if you follow them on Facebook, they love that house. I love their house, and I ain't never been there. Get a little jealous. I'm like, live out in the country, they got a pond and every stuff. They're why I got off of Facebook. No, I'm picking. I'm joking. That's not really. But what I'm saying is God did this. I didn't do it. God did it. And they're very quick to tell you that they didn't do it. God did it. Now, their income didn't change. What changed? Where they placed their treasure. That's what changed. See, it's not the purchase you place. It's where you place the purchase. It's the heart. It's where your treasure is. It's where you, the location of, if you had a treasure, where would you put it? He says, you give it to me, you put me to the test. He says, I'm going to pour out blessings. You won't have enough room to receive it. And then he says this, your crops will be abundant, for I will guard them from insects and disease and coronavirus. I added that in there. That wasn't really in here. The Hebrew kind of, no, I'm picking. Your grapes will not fall off the vine before they are ripe, says the Lord of the army of heavens. I want you to see. He was like, look, I'm going all the way down to your crops. Even the smallest thing that you plant, which is a grape, which is that big, I'm going to protect them if you just put me first. That's the promises of God. I'm telling you, start, talk about it, right? Start tithing. If you haven't been, if you have been, thank you. Can I just say you're the most generous group of people I've ever been around? I just want to say that. I'm not preaching at you. I'm telling you, a lot of you guys are doing this, and it's incredible. And we're able to pay the bills and put money in the building fund most months, and it's incredible. You guys are so giving, and I just love that. I love when we have a need. Y'all pop up and go, hey, I want to do this. Man, get after it. Go do it. We want to help you do it. And so I love that about you guys. So don't hear what I'm not saying. I just want you to know that there is a blessing that's coming if you start doing what God told you to do. If you do what he says for you to do, you'll get what he says you'll get. If you do what he says you'll do, you'll get what he says you'll get every single time. This is important. Talk about it. Start tithing. Here's number three. This is very practical, but get out of debt. To make money less complicated in your life. And if you're like us, you've gotten out of debt, and you've gotten out of debt, and got back into debt, and got out of debt, and it's become a little bit of a cycle. Listen, when we were in the trailer, I took some field jobs. I was gone for months at a time, and I didn't want to make great money, but I was working a lot of hours. I was working 7-12, 7-14s on the road with extra pay. And Amy was home just paying stuff down, paying stuff off. Listen, before that, we were in trouble. When we first got married, listen, I had debt that she didn't know about. I had thousands in credit card debt I didn't tell her about. I do not recommend that. So I waited to tell her. Here's when I did it. And listen, y'all can be like, this dude is a horrible husband. I can't believe he's leading the church. But all right, I was about 23 when that happened, so it was about 5 years ago. So we're in the car on the way to a Christmas family thing. Girls in the back seat, they're probably 3 and 4. I was like, oh, yeah, I forgot to tell you. I got about $4,000 in credit card debt. Because what would happen was they were calling the house, and I would go in the other room and pretend like it was a sales call. I mean, I'm telling you, it was bad. It was not good. I didn't want her to worry about it. Because, listen, money means love to me. So if I felt we didn't have enough, then that means I didn't love her. That's how I really felt. And money means security to her. And listen, if we didn't have it, I knew she was going to be stressed about it. So I was paying our rent with a credit card that I couldn't pay the note on. I don't recommend this, y'all. Talk about it. Listen, I don't recommend you doing life the way I did it early on. I just don't. I've learned my lesson. Listen, nobody's perfect. Everybody in here has made mistakes that you wouldn't do it the same way you did it the last time you did it. That's just the way life is. That's how we. But listen, do the debt snowball. Dave Ramsey, I hate that guy. Not really. He's hard to listen to because they're like, man, I feel like an idiot. But it works. The stuff, it just go watch some of those videos. It tells you the same stuff over and over and over. Get out of, save $1,000. Get out of debt. Put three months worth up and just take all the baby steps. This is important. Get out of debt. It's important. Here's what the Bible says about your debt. Now, don't hear what I'm not saying, but this is what the Bible's saying. I ain't saying this. God says this. And so if you got an issue with this scripture, you talk to him. All right, here it is. Owe nothing to anyone. Owe nothing to anyone. Now, that being said, we need about $3 million to build this building. You know what we're asking God for? $3 million. And it may not even cost that much. We're praying that it's even cheaper than that. We're saying, God, let me just give you real quick three things we're praying for in these 21 days of prayer, and we're going to keep praying for. One is $3 million. One is 20 new people working in the kids' building, kids' church. Some of y'all working in the kids' church, yeah, praise Jesus. Bring that on. We need 20 new people in the kids' building. We're praying for that and 100 baptisms. That's the thing. And God gave that word to one of our elders, and we said, this is we're going to hold on to this. This is where God's leading us. And so we're praying. And listen, these are not small prayers. And one of the prayers that was prayed this morning, I love this prayer, was prayed this morning in our prayer time. God, we don't know where it's going to come from, and we don't need to know. We just got to trust you. Got to trust you. But in our everyday life, he says, owe nothing to anyone. Here's why. Because they have something on you when you owe them that. Because I don't owe anything to anyone. Here's number five real quick, or number four real quick. Let me give you this. Start saving. So talk about it. Have a conversation. If you never talk about money in your family, it's a problem. You got to talk about it. Start tithing. Get out of debt. Here's another practical thing. Start saving. That's what we're doing right now as a church. Almost $300,000 in our building fund right now. And we're going to keep, as you guys give, we're going to keep building that up. And the faster we're going to move at the speed of your giving, and so that's how we're going to do it. We're going to start saving. We're going to keep saving as a church. And more money comes in every month than we need. We actually budget 90% of what came in last year. Every one of our budgets, 90% less than it was, the giving was the year before. That's how we do things. We want to keep that gap there. Here's what the Bible says about our savings. Good people leave an inheritance to their grandchildren. Good people leave an inheritance to their grandchildren. Did you mean you leave them millions of dollars? No, you don't leave them in a bond. Good people leave an inheritance to their grandchildren. Here's the question I want to end with this morning. I want to give you this thought that we've already been talking about. But you have to answer this question. I can't answer it. You have to answer this question. That is this. Who is the Lord of your money? If you're angry this morning because of this message, it ain't the Lord. It ain't God. I'll tell you that right now. If this message upset you, then God's not the Lord of your money. It's the thing that needs to be talked about the most and the thing we probably talk about the least. It's important. And again, money is not, it's the love of money. It's not the purchase you place, it's where you place the purchase. God doesn't care about your money. He cares about your motives. He cares about your motives. It's about a heart. The Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. And that word means hilarious. It means you laugh all the way. As you're writing the check for the tithe, as you're writing the check to help somebody out, you just can't stop laughing. You just love to give. Listen, let me just say it like this, and this is going to come harsh, and I didn't talk to the leadership team before I said this, but let me just say it like this. If you give begrudgingly here at WRC, just keep it. Yeah. Hope it's okay. I said that. If writing a check to the church or helping anybody makes you angry, just keep it, because it ain't no gift. It ain't being received as a tithe, because God loves a cheerful giver. You can't do these things going, okay, God, I want you to make sure I don't want to get the coronavirus. I'm writing this check. You make sure you protect me. That's not what this is about. Listen, we don't give to get. We give to give. It's the thing Jesus talked about the most. You know why? Because we usually place it above him in our life, because it becomes our God. We don't praise it. We don't worship it, but we start depending on it a little too much. Give it to God. He can do more with $10 than you can do with $1 million. But you've got to give it to him. You got to give it to him.